hopekelowna.ca. There's an online connection card there if you desire to attend any classes or submit any prayer requests. And if you want to sign up for our e-news email, you can do that by going to hopekelowna.ca and clicking connect. If you've come prepared to give this morning, there's an offering box and envelopes at the back. And you can also give online as well by going to hopekelowna.ca and clicking give. So let us worship together with the Lord in song, prayer, and word. So would you stand with us as we worship the Lord?
Thank you, Casey, and good morning, everybody. Well, let's get started in our time of worship of the Lord this morning with a reading from Psalm 33, verses 1 to 5. It says, "Shout for joy in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright. Give thanks to the Lord with the lyre. Make melody to him with the harp of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts. For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord." So as we wash our hearts and minds in the word of God daily, we can't help but praise him. God's righteousness and justice are a comfort to his people in an unjust and corrupt world. So let's remember God's steadfast love towards us this morning. Amen. We live and breathe by his grace alone. He wasn't content to leave us enslaved to our fleshly desires, destined for eternity apart from him. He sent his son Jesus to reconcile us to God and to give us a hope and a future. So let's join the beauty of God's creation in shouting his worth and glory this morning. Amen.
Praise the Lord, all the earth,
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad. I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense. So I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I've built my life on Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't. Is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad. I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. be seated. Let's pray together. Join me in prayer. Oh God, you are our solid ground, our refuge, our fortress, our firm foundation. All our hope is in you alone. You never fail us, Lord. You've promised to carry out to completion all the work that you've begun in us. But if we're honest before you this morning, oh Lord, we can have a hard time believing this. We're distracted people. The cares of the world and the deceitfulness and our abundance choke your word, and it can prove unfruitful. We come to church, but we struggle in areas of sin and doubt. Yet we know in Romans 12, your word calls us to offer our bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable. Today we'll hear in Ecclesiastes how we are to guard our steps when we go into the house of the Lord. Because of who you are and what we've done and what you've done, we feel a pull on our hearts to confess and repent and recognize our sin for what it is, which is against you and you alone, the God of the universe. Your word says, as we confess and repent of our sin, you are faithful and just to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So I invite you now to join me. Let's take a moment of silent reflection. Let's hear from God and confess to him. So as we continue in praise and worship this morning and the preaching of the word, that we enter into that with clean hands and a pure heart. In Psalm 51, it says, "Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew in me a right spirit. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit." So let's go to him now in prayer and silent reflection and humble ourselves. For today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Let's pray.
Gathered at the high throne, welcomed by a melody, an anthem I evoke, no, a song that's always been in me. All glory and honor, dominion and power to you.
Would you stand with us as we continue in worship?
A million angels fall, face down on the floor, all to echo, "Holy is the Lord." My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven roll, forever echo, "Holy is the Lord." Oh, oh, oh. Forever echo, "Holy is the Lord." Memorize
Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness.
God, we come to you, the Holy One, the Mighty One. We have been singing songs of truth. We have been confessing areas of sin, areas of shortcomings, areas in our lives that have been covered so beautifully by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And we are so grateful and so thankful. And God, I pray that even now as your children here listen to your word as it is proclaimed here this morning, oh God, we pray that you would meet us mightily, that what we are doing here Sunday after Sunday and what we are doing here today wouldn't be worthless. It wouldn't be in the end just a waste of time, that it wouldn't be just ritual, it wouldn't be routine, but oh God, it would be renewing our hearts and our souls and our minds and our thoughts and our attitudes and our actions. Oh God, work mightily in each one of us. We need you. Work mightily in me. Work mightily in my friends here today. Oh God, would you meet us by your Holy Spirit working through the proclamation of your word. We pray that you would transform us today, that we would reflect and live for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in a greater all-in fashion, that you would be our first and foremost passion in our lives. Oh God, meet us, we pray. We need you. We ask this all in the precious and the mighty name of Jesus. And all the people said, amen. And let's get to it. All right. Take your Bibles. And if you don't have a copy of God's word in your hand this morning, the ushers would love to put a copy of God's word in your hands this morning, and they're walking down the aisles with a Bible that you can use today, or you can take that home with you if you don't have a copy of God's word. And we're in Ecclesiastes chapter 5 today, Ecclesiastes chapter 5. And just a few things to be in the know about, just that you're aware of. And we're doing this so that we can end our service in attitude and heart of worship and prayer. And oftentimes we have announcements at the end, but want to just leave opportunity for God to move and to work in your heart, and to even spend time perhaps in prayer at the end. At the end of our time together today, So I'm not crying because I'm talking about step one. Step one, and a baptism class next Sunday will be taking place. And if you are new to Hope Bible Church, you've never been to step one, or it's been a while, or you have a friend who is newer, and say, hey, let's go together. And you can have pizza with me, with the pastor, and with some of the other leaders at the church. And that will be in the Family Ministry Center after the second service next week. And then at the same time, there's going to be a baptism class. If you have not yet been baptized as a believer, it's time for you to do that. If you are indeed a believer in Jesus Christ and haven't been baptized, it's time. And so that will be taking place. And both of these will be some time for some fellowship, a little bit of food, some pizza, and then a brief time together. It won't take up the whole afternoon or anything like that, because we know that next Sunday is some football game that the United States people go crazy over. So that's next Sunday. Let us know if you are going to be a part of that. You can sign up online for the step one or through the e-news. All right, so Ecclesiastes chapter 5, this book of Ecclesiastes that we're studying as we are going through it chapter after chapter is the account of one man, of King Solomon, on a search. He is on a search. He is chasing. He is looking, he is searching for purpose and meaning and significance that here on this earth, he's looking for purpose, meaning, significance, lasting pleasure. He's looking for something that will be significant here on this earth, and it's in a life, in a search that is independent of God. And oftentimes it's referred to as life under the sun. And so it's life here on the creation of God's, and it's trying to find this purpose and meaning and significance. And so with unlimited resources that he has, and unlimited time, because he's the king and he can do whatever he wants, he sets out on this pursuit. And yet he finds with great accomplishments, he finds with the accumulation and enjoyment of vast wealth, with the greatest of education that one could ever achieve to in those days, including the pursuit then of pleasure and the party life. He lived life to the full, to the maximum, and yet he sprinkled that with hard and meaningful toil and work that he enjoyed, and he buried himself in the work that he loved to do. And even then, he had great power to rule over people, have people at his command. He had servants and slaves and people who did whatever he so wanted. He ruled over nations and countries, various nations and countries. He had unlimited sex. He had whatever he wanted when it came to that. He had the ability to build great and mighty things, making a great name for himself, leaving much to the next generation to bless the next generation. And Solomon, in doing all of these things, despite the temporary excitement and the rush and the laughter and the good times, the party didn't continue to keep going. He found the greater the pursuits, the greater the achievements, the more that he accomplished, there was more despair and more emptiness, more vanity. And it's referred to in Hebrew as hevel. He refers to it as hevel. It's vanity. It's fleeting. It's like a vapor. Here, one moment, and then it's gone. Well, in chapter 5, at least the first 7 verses, Solomon takes a break from lamenting the whole earth, the whole universe for that matter, and he focuses his attention on religion. He focuses his attention on religion and worship. And he even points out that our worship, even what we're doing here today, has the potential, or even in our own God time daily as we open up God's word and spend time with him, or in our group time with others throughout the week, that even in pursuing these all in and being committed and faithful to this can easily become empty and can even, as he says, part ways through verse 7, vanity. Here, and then it's gone. Now, Solomon, being King David's son, could perhaps be considered an expert when it came to approaching God. He grew up in church, after all. His father was very religious, a man after God's own heart. And I guess you could say, well, in the Old Testament version of church, and in some ways he would be considered a PK. A PK is typically referred to as a pastor's kid. And anyone who is a pastor's kid my kids included, believe that there will be special rewards in heaven for pastor's kids. Look at this cute little one that I got to hold when we were in Mexico a few weeks ago. This is little Olive Wilkerson and her dad, Godfrey, and mom, Amelia. Godfrey is the pastor at the Parry Sound, Ontario, Great Commission Collective Church, and so got to hang out with her and enjoy that. And we sent that picture to our kids, and our daughter right away replied, "How come she got to go to the pastor's retreat in Mexico? They should have one that includes all pastors' kids, because after all that we've had to endure, you know." And then I got sent this week, and it would be so true of pastors' kids for sure. This T-shirt, pastor warning. Anything you say or do could be used in a sermon. And so our house for all the years and even still is used very much as sermon illustrations. And so yes, there is going to be a certain reward, I believe, in heaven for pastor's kids. And yet Solomon wasn't really a pastor's kid, but he was a PK. He was a psalmist kid. Right? King David wrote many psalms, and even Solomon refers to himself in chapter 1, I think right in verse 1, he refers to himself as the preacher, and so he is a preacher. He is a psalmist kid. He is a PK. He grew up with religion, and later on in his life, he instituted, he built, he oversaw the building of the temple that took 7 years and 153,000 laborers to complete. It was an incredible accomplishment. And verse 7, though, he concludes that even with great devotion, even with great expressions and routines and rituals, that our worship can become worthless worship. It can become vanity and it can become empty. It can be going just simply through the motions. Perhaps that would reflect your heart today and maybe for some time now. Because if we are to be honest, maybe you have or are feeling that way. Maybe you're even wondering today, why am I even here? I'm here today out of ritual, out of routine. I'm here because it's, I guess, good for me. You heard about the wife that went and woke up her husband and said, "Come on, it's Sunday morning, we have to go to church." And he says, "Give me three good reasons why we should go to church this morning." And she says, "Well, it will do you some good. And it's a good example for the children." He says, "What's the third?" She said, "You're the pastor. Get up. Get going." You know, and sometimes it's like that. And so we may be wondering, why am I even here? I mean, because perhaps even today on that, from within, you're looking out. You're looking across the room. You look at others. And you're saying, why am I here? As you examine and think about the state of your heart and you hear those voices, "You don't deserve to be here. You're a failure. You don't measure up." And you look at people across the room and you see them singing and hands raised, maybe even at times tears flowing. And during the preaching, you see people with their Bibles open and they're taking notes and they're, amen, and they're just all in. You see others who are joyfully serving week after week. And truth be known, your serving is like out of duty, out of responsibility, if at all. And if you were to be honest here today, you would say, "I'm dry. I'm parched. And in actuality, I'd rather run and hide. I should have stayed in bed." And a part of you can't help but to think, "Am I missing something? Am I missing something? Is it just the cylinders aren't all functioning, aren't going. There's a problem here." And you're kind of like screaming on the inside for help. "I need a boost of some sort. Maybe I should try another church. Maybe get a new voice." I mean, sports teams do that. They fire the coach when the team isn't doing so well, and maybe a new voice will help me and kind of get me going. Or maybe I'll find some others who are more like-minded and are similar to where I'm at, where I can fit in better. And we hear these voices and these thoughts go through our head, and then someone suggests to you, as you're talking about being kind of dry and kind of parched and just not really feeling it, and maybe they say, "Well, you need the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You need fullness." And then someone else says to you, "You need the 5 points of Calvinism nailed down into your life. You need truth." And you're kind of like, where am I at with this? And so doubts and discouragement and dryness creeps in. And even these doubts, of where's God in my life right now? Where is God in the situations that dear loved ones that we care about and love are facing? Where is God in this broken and messed up world? Where is God when perhaps you wonder and you doubt if he will forgive you because you are having a hard time forgiving someone else who has hurt you deeply? And so you're wondering, how can God forgive me if I'm not willing to forgive? And these doubts and these questions, the things that are going on, things that God has allowed in your life, in your family, and in loved ones. And there will be times for all of us where we will get rocked by life circumstances, by the circumstances of those around us that we know and we love. And then there's the discouragement because of, at times, the actions or the inactions of others, and so we feel hurt and betrayed and let down. Or the discouragement that comes because of the struggle with sin, that vice, that addiction, that no matter how hard I try, no matter all the things I do, it still haunts me. Or there's this disintegrating marriage or family relationships, disintegrating health or finances. And it just seems that God doesn't seem that powerful. He seems distant. And then we hear a sermon. And the sermon or the podcast or the book, it almost sets us up for failure because we hear four ways to conquer sin or five ways to beat worry or the five best practices to a better prayer life or three steps for your miracle. And you do the steps and you pray and nothing changes. Or maybe you pray and you do the steps and there's victory for 2 weeks or for 6 months, but then you back at it worse than ever before. How do we approach God in times like this? Do we even approach him at all, or do we run? Do we just sit in the corner, suck our thumb, and just rock back and forth? Solomon gives us five directives that I believe today, if taken, will and can ignite the heart. That will ignite the heart that where it seems God's power and God's presence has been snuffed out. These directives are for the dry and the discouraged heart. Directives that take us from faking and pretending and just going through the motions to what I believe can and will be an engagement with our God in authentic exaltation of him, of experiencing and knowing his presence in our lives. This first directive that Solomon gives to us is let's pay attention to our feet. I encourage you to be writing these down today or snapping pictures. In the end, you'll see all five of them towards the end of the message. But these five directives that maybe right now you're not even in the place, or maybe you're in a good place, but you're going to be in this place in time, and we're going to need these five directives that will ignite the heart. And the first one is, let's pay attention to our feet. Look at verse 1 of Ecclesiastes chapter 5. It says, guard your steps when you go to the house of God. He says, pay attention to your feet, because the direction of your feet is determining the direction of your life. Years ago, at a church we were pastoring in Alberta, I stopped by on a Saturday afternoon to work on my sermon a little bit, and I cut across the grass, and I came up just kind of the side, just similar to this, and I stood up, and we had a big wooden pulpit in that church, and I was standing up there, and I was just going over my sermon a little bit, and as I'm about 10 minutes into, I'm like, man, this thing stinks. Whew, it's bad. Like, this is just... And then I realized it wasn't the sermon that stunk. I realized that on my way into the church, I stepped on some dog stuff. And then I looked and I saw these little dog stuff marks all the way from the door all the way up to the front. And no wonder things were stinky. And the next hour was spent cleaning and disinfecting and trying to get rid of the smell. And then the smell on your hands after, yeah, okay, I don't even need to go into it. I mean, and it was just like, okay, this isn't good. But I was walking into church that day, and I had no idea what was on the bottom of my feet. But it was quite a mess. And in a similar way, what can accumulate in our lives, what can accumulate on our feet and that we walk around with, and the direction that we go will and can affect our relationship with God and our relationship with others. If we were to look, if you were to do an examination of your life, of your thoughts, of your attitudes, of your actions, of your endeavors, of your hopes and your dreams from the last 7 days, would they be that of pursuing and chasing after God? Would they be about thinking about Him? Would they be about Him or about your own dreams and aspirations and hurts and failures and blessings? And would what we are thinking about and where we are going and where we are spending our time and our energy, are they stirring our affections for Christ? Are they pleasing to God, or are they taking us away from Him? You see, in Colossians 3, it says, if you then have been raised with Christ, if you are in Christ, it says, seek the things that are above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on the things of this earth. How much in the last 7 days have we spent time thinking about eternity, about the kingdom, about the mission that we have been given? Or Philippians chapter 4, verse 8 tells us where our minds ought to be. It says, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. This is where our minds are to be. But so oftentimes they're in the gutter of discouragement, the gutter of critique. We so easily stray away from this, and we dwell on the opposite of this. And you see, we may think that at times we get a pass into God's presence. We showed up in church. We're singing. There's emotion. There's these feelings of well, maybe it's God's presence. I don't know, but it's good. Last Sunday night, what a night for God's people in gathered worship. And in time of prayer and worship and just exalting our great God, it was lovely, it was beautiful, and yet just because we're a part of that doesn't necessarily mean we're experiencing or walking in God's presence. We just think if we show up to church or go to group or in our God time that we think in doing so that all of a sudden the Shekinah glory of God will all of a sudden descend upon us. And we'll experience His power, His presence, His peace in our lives. No, it's crazy to think that our lives can be full of idle or prideful or selfish pursuits or unconfessed sin or staying up late or filling our minds, our lives with a bunch of nonsense. And then we drag our sorry butts into church on a Sunday morning, tired and weary, maybe even some hungover. And we think that when the worship leader says a few verses, that presto, we become spirit-filled worshipers of the Almighty God. We need to think again if we think this. You see, God has always restricted the access to His presence. He demands holiness. And it seems that over the years, the church, we've gone away from emphasizing and talking about personal holiness and purity, and our emphasis is how much can we be like the world and still be saved. And we've moved away from holiness and this requirement of God. He demands holiness from His people. And for us to be in His presence and to truly experience, not emotionalism, but His power, it comes personal holiness, by examining what's on our feet. What have we been dragging ourselves through? What have we been dragging others through with our mouths? Psalm 24, verse 3, who may ascend to the hill of the Lord and stand in His holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully, he will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. And God provides us with that access point. It's not doing a whole bunch of good deeds or a bunch of rituals. We don't earn God's favor. We don't earn his attention. No, it's through Jesus. It's through Jesus. He's the only access point for us to be able to truly enter into the presence of our great God. He alone is the one who paid the penalty for our sins. You, no matter how much good work, no much money you give, you cannot tip the scales of justice for you to become or to be declared righteous on your own. It's in and only through Jesus Christ. Jesus alone, God in the flesh, the eternal Son of God, came to this earth. He lived a perfect life. He paid the penalty for our sin. And he alone, through his sacrifice on the cross, though he did nothing wrong, was the perfect sacrifice, was the perfect substitute. He takes our sin. He gives us his righteousness. To all who would ask, all who would receive, all who would believe, all who would repent. And he provides that covering for our sin, for our uncleanness. He provides the covering for our addictions, our anger, our bitterness. His blood was shed so we can be cleansed, so we can have right standing before God. And so we come, in Psalm 139:23, it says, "Search me, O God. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there's any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." That verse, write that one down. That should be at the forefront of our God time. That should be the forefront of our lives before we get together and worship. That should be even at the forefront when we gather with others in our group time study. Search me, O God, and confess any of those areas of sin. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful, he is just, and he will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from most unrighteousness. Did I add a word in there? Yeah. He will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so it's, search me, God, forgive me. It's examining our feet and like, what kind of junk have I picked up on my feet this week, this month, today even? And ask for and receive his cleansing. The cleansing that comes from a life that is surrendered as we place ourselves under the presence of our great and our mighty God. It's there, it's then that he meets us with the clean hands and a pure heart that comes through forgiveness, through repentance. And he meets his children. Hebrews 4:6 says that then we can approach the throne of grace with confidence. We can approach him with confidence and receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Solomon says, watch your feet. Examine. Look at the direction of your life. Your goals, your hopes, your aspirations. Are they infused with God's plan and God's will for your life? Or have you come up with your plan and you're now telling him what to do? Hebrews 12:14 is such a great reminder, because I think this is where so oftentimes God's presence gets snuffed out, his power gets snuffed out. It says, strive for peace with everyone and for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. Are you living at peace? And then I think it's Romans 15. It says, seek to live at peace with all people as such as you are able to do. There's some people who won't want peace with you, but you are to seek peace and pursue it with others. Because when we're out of sync in relationships, we're out of sync in our relationship with God. Because without the holiness, no one will see the Lord. Preparation is vital. How's your feet? How's the direction of your life? Oh, that we would be on a Sunday morning when we open the Word for our God time, when we go to our groups, when we go throughout the day, would we be tuned in? Would we be fessed up? Would we be confessed up? And would we be bowed low in humility before him? Second directive that we see here that Solomon gives is open our ears. Look at it, second part of verse 1. It says, to draw near to listen is better than to offer the sacrifice of fools. For they do not know that they are doing evil. It's vital that we have our ears open. We open our ears. That we hear God's word and we listen to it. We just don't know it, but we hear it and we listen. We do something about it. It's placing ourselves under the Scripture, under the Scripture's authority, listening even to the songs that we were singing. Did you pay attention to the songs that we were singing this morning? They're filled with just deep, rich truths. And it's listening to them and allowing them to impact our lives and our thinking. When God's word is read, when God's word is preached, it's about having ears open to be taught, to be renewed, to be revived from God's word. Not just to sharpen your argument or to look smart in the eyes of others. We listen to God's word to be transformed. Oh, that we would see God as we hear God's word, as it is proclaimed. Would we hear with our ears and understand that we have a God who is holy, a God who is transcendent, a God who is mighty, a God who is loving, a God who is gracious, yet a God who looks and sees sin as serious. Sadly, we bring God down to our level. We make our relationship with him so much more horizontal that God is our buddy. And we bring him down to a level that he would be uncomfortable with. A God who is soft on sin. A God who is kind of soft on personal holiness. It's really not that big of a deal. Or God who doesn't hold us to account for our actions or our ways. He understands everything. And so he cuts me a break on these things. A God who is fine with the lies that we are being fed in media, even in sadly in some churches even today, about marriage, about sexuality, about gender, about sex outside of marriage. Oh, no, we have an understanding, God. Like, you know, I'm weak and it's okay. God understands. Or about shady business practices while everyone else is doing it, and yet we know and we've heard what God's word says. Solomon is saying that it's vital that we open our ears to hear God's word and to listen. What is God's word saying to me? Every time that we're hearing God's word, when you leave here today, even as God's word is being proclaimed, having that heart, what's he saying to me? God, what are you saying to me today through your word? Through the teaching? Is there correction? Is there conviction? Is there encouragement? Are there promises I need to cling to in the word of God? Thirdly, third directive is let's watch our mouth. Look at verse 2. It says, be not rash with your mouth, nor let your heart be hasty to utter a word before God. For God is in heaven and you are on earth. Therefore, let your words be few. For a dream comes with much busyness, and a fool's voice with many words. He's saying here, we've got to watch our mouths. This is where we need to be careful what we are saying in prayer to God, but even what we are saying in prayer when others are around, but even in conversation with others. This is a warning about meaningless and mechanical prayer and worship. Let's be careful about the Christian dribble, the cliches that can just come out of our mouth that we use to try to impress others. This much dreaming here is a reference to great and excessive talk. It's just a mind that just won't shut off. You know, I remember the first time I heard it, there was one of our neighbor girls. I mean, she just talked like this, you know, and her brother called her motor mouth. I just thought that was the funniest thing that someone could, you know, but sometimes that's the way we are. Like our mouths are just, you know, we have an answer. We, you know, have a solution. We, you know, talk, we pray. We're so quick in this, but it can become meaningless. It can become mechanical. Be careful of what we are saying in contrast to how we are truly living our lives. How are we treating our spouse? How are we treating our colleagues? How are we treating family members? Oh, we can talk a big game. He says, let your words be few. Watch your mouths. Remember Jesus in Luke 18, two men were praying one day at the temple. And one was praying that high and lofty prayer, and oh, he was a religious man, and just prayed just this beautiful high fluting prayer. And then the other, a scum of the earth tax collector, cries out, and his prayer is so simple: "Is God be merciful to me, a sinner?" And Jesus says, "One man, One man's prayer was heard that day. One man's prayer touched heaven. One man left being heard and being justified. And it was the man who just said few words and just said, "Be merciful to me. Be merciful. Be merciful to me, oh God, a sinner." See, God hears and he sees the invisible, the inaudible. He doesn't listen to our prayers, you know, like how we have, I don't know where that might, okay, so God doesn't hear our prayers like through this, you know, like check, are you hearing God? You know, and so our prayers aren't through a microphone for God. No, they're not like that at all. They're, for God, he uses like a spiritual stethoscope. He takes the stethoscope and he places it over our heart and the words are coming out of a microphone and sound great to everyone else, but he has a true heartbeat on what's really going on in our lives. He places it over our heart. He knows what's really going on. We can fool others, but we can't fool him. That's why we need to pay attention to our feet. We need to open our ears. We need to hear the word of God and how he's speaking to me, that we would obey him. We'd watch our mouths, watch the dribble. And then fourthly, we are to keep our vows. Look at verse 4. It says, "When you vow a vow to God, do not delay in paying it. For he has no pleasure in fools. Pay what you vow. It is better that you should not vow than that you should vow and not pay. Let not your mouth lead you into sin, and do not say before the messenger that it was a mistake." And the word messenger is oftentimes also referred to as a priest. "Why should God be angry at your voice and destroy the work of your hands? For when dreams," in other words, busyness and lots of words and lots of dribble, "when dreams increase and words grow many, oh, there is vanity." There is vanity. Here Solomon is saying that there's a great danger when we come to worship, when we open up the Word of God, when we gather with others. There's a danger when a sermon is preached and we know and we sense that the Holy Spirit is working and speaking and saying, "This way to life, this is the next step for you. This is what you ought to do." And we say, yes, and we're convicted and we're convinced about that area of sin, that area of obedience. This is what I ought to do. I need to get help. I need to forgive. I will do this. I need to get baptized. I need to come clean in this area. I need to break up with that guy. I need to break it off with that girl. I'm going to swallow my pride before my brother or that sister that I'm at odds with. I'm going to forgive. And we sense and we know this is the way that is leading to life. And I'm going to make these things right. I don't care. I don't care what happens. I don't care the price that I have to pay. I need to be right with God. I'm going to do this. Yes, I'm going to quit my job. I'm going to quit my job. I'm going to follow because that's what he's been telling me. And I've been ignoring him. And I'm going to do that. I need to step into that area of ministry. I've been putting it off. Yeah, I'm going to do it. I'm going to get into that group. I'm going to go to Freedom Group. I'm in. Lord, I'll do it. And we say, yes. This is the way to life. I know it. That's that next step. And God always works in the next step. He doesn't work 10 and 15. We're so focused on the steps way down over here. And he says, no, what's that next step? And we hear that next step and we know what it is. And we say, yes, I'm going to do it. I'm in. And we walk out of here leaving with good intentions, having made that vow and that commitment to God. And the preacher is saying here, hey, be careful. Don't delay in fulfilling it. And don't deny that you made it. Because here is what, and oftentimes we can find that hours or days or weeks or months later. Sadly, sometimes years can go by, and we find ourselves in the desert, and there's no joy, and there's no victory, and it just seems like everything's crumbling around in us. There's this dryness and this distance in our lives with God, with others, and we become snooty, and we become angry, and we become ticked off. People are like, what's it with you? What's up? And we can find ourselves wasting away in cynicism and a critical spirit and emptiness. Even David said when he was holding on to his sin, when he was cherishing his sin, he said it was like my bones were wasting away. It can affect us physically. It affects our health. That our bodies can waste away. And God seems so distant. If this is any of us here today in our lives, where it just seems that there's this dryness and this distance, and we need to do an examination before the Lord, and maybe it's even not even that hard to do, because it's right there, you know what it is, and we need to check and say, is there somewhere in my journey with God where I kind of said, no, I'm denying it or I'm delaying it? And we continue to say no, and the Holy Spirit woos and leads, but then even after a while, His voice starts to become faint. Rather than delaying or denying the working, that next move that the Holy Spirit reveals to you from the Word of God, through the proclaimed Word, through the written Word, just do it. Say, yes, I'm in. I don't care. I need to be right with God. There's such a joy and blessing on the other side of that obedience. On this side, it's hell. On the other side of the obedience, it's life. Now, I need to say this because it can be super unpopular. But sometimes God ordains the desert. He ordains dry and difficult seasons for His children. He ordains the wilderness. And it's not because of sin, because of disobedience, not because of unkept vows, or because God is angry at you. But at times He ordains the desert and hardship and trials and betrayals because He loves you, because He's crazy about you. And He wants us to seek hard after Him, even in the wilderness. In the process, more than likely, He's going to want to kill some stuff in us that we didn't even know necessarily was there, but it's for our good. And yet in His mercy, He will show us things about Himself that we would learn no other way. Just as we were getting ready to leave for Christmas with our family, I saw a book on my bookstand that's been sitting there for a couple years. And it was just like, you got to take that book with you, Meldon. And as I was reading it, I was like, oh, Lord, what are You sending us into? What are You sending me into? It's a book called, and we ordered 20 of them, and it probably won't be enough, as I have never, other than the Word of God, hugged a book so carefully as far as just the necessity and the joy and the understanding that it has brought. And it's called Dark Clouds, Deep Mercy. And the desert that we go through, or that we walk with others through, can be long. It can be weeks, it can be months, it can be years. And oftentimes it won't make sense. But it's in these times that we cry out to God. We cry out in a lament to Him. And a lament is good. You know, we talked about watch the dribble, watch the excess talking. Give it all to God. Just say whatever you want. He wants to hear the dribble. He wants to hear the excess talking. He can handle it. He wants your questions. He wants your frustration. He wants, God, I don't get You. I don't understand You. I don't even know if I love You. He'll get that. He can handle it. A lament is a complaint before God. A third of the Psalms are laments. We have a whole book, Lamentations, which is a lament before God. And a lament is the song that we sing. It is the prayer that we pray. It is the truth that we cling to between the pain and the promise. And Psalms, especially David, I mean, can be such a friend in dry times, in the wilderness. And at times you just may need to say, okay, God, I'm just going to read this back to You because this is what Your Word says. I mean, David is probably one of the most schizophrenic guys you'll ever meet. From I love You, God, to where are You? I can't figure. I love You, God. You are amazing. Just flip the page. Just look at the next verse. And we just see Him and He's just pouring it out and it's beautiful. That was a man after God's heart. And at times we just need to simply and yet so powerfully just read the promises of Scripture and read them back to Him and says, you said in your word that you'll never leave me, you'll never forsake me. And God says, I'm with you. And sometimes it's walking with others in the body of Christ in the wilderness. I think of Don and Marla Lee Martin right now walking through the wilderness of serious health issues and concerns. And we lament and we cry out on their behalf. And in our own lives, we look at how God is wanting to teach and to lead us in this time. But God can handle it. We remind God that you tell us in your word that we won't be tempted, we won't be tried beyond what we're able to bear, and at some point we say, God, time out. I can't bear anymore, I can't take anymore. So we pay attention to our feet, we draw near to Him and listen. Let's not be a pretending church. Hope Church, you and I, we need to be a place where it's okay to not be okay. It's dangerous to stay that way. So let's not stay that way, but we're going to go through that. We're going to go through the wilderness, but let's be honest with God, with one another. Let's surrender before Him and man. Let's put ourselves under the weight and the truth of Scripture and listen and obey as the Spirit of God leads us out of the desert, and He will. Eventually in His time, in His way. And yet even in the desert, He will provide beautiful oases. It may be all dry and dead and barren and sand and what are those that grow in the desert? Cactus and basically nothing else. And wild animals. But He provides an oasis in the midst of the desert for His own. He won't abandon us. And He'll keep saying, this way to water, this way to life. And then Solomon closes with the fifth directive. And it says, the end of verse 7, it says, but God is the one you must fear. That fifth directive is stand in awe. That God is the one we are to fear. This isn't a fear that is a terror fear. This isn't being afraid of Him. It's a reverential fear. It is the reaction to God's holiness. This is to stand in breathtaking awe at the character of God, of the love of God, and yet to realize that we have been made in His image. We've been made, you were made to stand in His presence. You were made, you were designed to live forever with Him. But our sin, we have, because of our sin, we have forfeited that privilege and that destiny. And He detests the sin that is in us. And yet He loves us so much and detests the sin. And He knows that my sin, my past, my present, He knows everything about it. And yet He loves us more than we could ever know. And He offers mercy and forgiveness. He offers life now and forevermore. This is what it means to fear God, to be in awe that He would take somebody as messed up and as broken as you are, as I am, as we are, and He says, come here, my child. This is how and why we ought to be filled with breathtaking awe, that as we will be singing in a few moments, I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. As you hold the bread in your hand, as you take that cup, and you think of His love, the blood that was shed, His body that was broken for you and for me, for our salvation. A sinner who's been condemned unclean, and yet because of the blood of Christ, we are new, we are forgiven. And so as we pay attention to our feet, as we open our ears, as we watch our mouth, as we keep our vows, as we stand in awe to live, to fear God, in this way is not to dread the frown of God upon our lives, but it's to live under the smile of God, the love of God, the approval of God. When we offer ourselves in surrender and worship, and when we offer ourselves in song as we sing from the heart, when we serve Him, we sacrifice for Him, our Father accepts what we offer and give Him. out of love, no matter how minuscule, no matter how crummy it might be, how insignificant we think it is. He's not looking for perfect people, but people who are humble, who are honest. You know, every parent, every grandparent has, more than likely, has drawers or boxes or file folders or bulletin boards or fridges full of drawings from your kids or your grandkids. I mean, I just found this the other day, and I mean, this stuff just, I mean, I was moving it from one place to another, and it's just like, man, this stuff just isn't very good. I mean, my kids, I mean, over the years, you know, like they made these cards and these drawings. I mean, happy Father's Day, Dad, I love you. Like, that's supposed to be a football. Yeah, like, you know, that's good. You know, like, yeah, like my kids aren't going to win any art awards or anything like this. But you know what? I hold on to these. They're precious. I was looking at them this week, and I thought of the little kid, my little son at that time, and now big son, and he still writes beautiful cards. Thankfully, he doesn't draw. He just doesn't do that anymore, which is good. But it was coming. It was made. It was offered to me in love. I mean, look at this. I mean, this is just ugly. You know, like this was a Father's Day thing that he gave. But you know where it is? It's like at the front entrance of our house inside. You'll see it if you come by, stand at our front door, and you'll see it right there. Because it's lovely. It's beautiful. It was given to me from a child, from my child, from my son. And so whatever we then give to God with a clean hands, with a pure heart, in service, in worship, in obedience, no matter how small, how minuscule, he says, that's beautiful. That's beautiful. I love you. They were made, they were offered in love. And as we do that, we are the object of his affection. And I ask you to bow your heads at this time. Band is going to come, and communion servers, if you could come at this time as well. The Lord's Supper today is an opportunity for you to receive it from up front here. A piece of bread will be placed in your hand, and a cup you can take from the table. And then take it back to your seat, and when you are ready, partake when you are ready. There won't be a time at the end. This is to be a time of worship, a time of surrender, a time of repentance, a time of thanksgiving. And it's for believers in Jesus Christ. So if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, who is taking to heart what we're talking about today with a heart of confession and repentance, this is for you. If you're not a believer in Jesus Christ, it's more important that you come to faith in Jesus Christ. In fact, don't partake if you're not a believer in Jesus Christ yet. Instead, after the service, there'll be prayer partners at the front who would love to pray for you and with you and help you in that. But loved ones, today, if you're in the wilderness, if you're in the desert, of your own doing, or perhaps because God is allowing it right now, he's ordaining the desert, the wilderness. Today, his Spirit, through his word, gives us direction and says, this way out, this way to life. Loved ones, before we partake, let's be paying attention to our feet. Let's have our ears open to what the Spirit is saying to us through God's word today. Let's watch our mouths, what we say to him, what we say to others. If there's areas we need to confess, we need to make right. Let's get on that. Let's keep our vows. And let's take time to stand in awe of our great and our wonderful Savior. Our service is then going to close. I'll come up after the songs and have a closing prayer, but I'd love for things to end today in a heart and an attitude of worship and prayer. If you want to stay here afterwards, your seat and just spend some time praying, encourage you to do so. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke the bread, and he says, this bread represents my broken body, which is for you. And then after supper, he took the cup, and he says, this cup is the new covenant. It is representing my blood shed for you. Do this to remember my love, my sacrifice. And so as we spend this time in worship, as you partake on your own, when you're ready, you partake and come and receive and partake back at your seat. Let's spend some time together examining our feet, ears open, guarding our mouths, saying yes to him in obedience. And so, Lord Jesus, we pray that you would meet your children here today. Meet us broken, beaten, for some rejoicing and thankful, knowing even in their own lives how you have led them through the wilderness and through the desert, but knowing full well that the wilderness will happen again and again for us as your children, and yet you are faithful and you will meet us there. Would our worship be real, hearts that are pure, hands that are clean. We pray this in the precious and the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Partake when you are ready.
I stand amazed in the presence, Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone, singing, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Singing, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Singing, how marvelous, how wonderful in my song shall ransomed in glory. His face I at last shall see. It will be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you.
Would you stand with us now as we continue to respond to God in worship? Stand in awe of him as we pour out our hearts to him. We get to stand with our hearts abandoned to him. We get to give our whole selves to him. So let's continue to do that.
So I'll stand, arms high and heart abandoned.
And so, Heavenly Father, we come to you now and we pray that how the Spirit has been speaking to us here today for each one of us, where we're hearing those words, this way to water, this way to life, this way to freedom, would we follow you through on that, confessing, repenting where we need to, humbling ourselves before you, before others, where we ought to. And then walking in faith, knowing the love of the Father is upon us. And even in the dry times when you feel distant, as we stay committed to your word and to worship, and knowing that you will provide faithfully an oasis for us, even in the wilderness, even in the dry times, that you are there. You do not abandon us. You don't want us to go through rituals or routines, but to experience you, your presence, your power in our lives. Meet us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Prayer partners will be at the front to pray with you. And as I said, we're going to close our time just a little quietly. And the band, maybe you could just even do that. Lord, I need you, just quietly as people leave here today. I just would love for you to spend some time in prayer and to be praying for our dear brother and sister, Don and Marla Lee, mention them in my message. Today they are both in the hospital. Just a short time ago, Marla Lee was diagnosed with ALS. And them being core group members in the life of this church, this is, and so dear to so many of us, this is hard news. But she was taken in yesterday to expedite some of the care for her as there's a lot of decline that's been happening with her. Dawn was taken in yesterday and was found to have a massive brain bleed, probably from a fall that happened in November, and some of you would have seen his bruised up face from that, and the doctor doesn't even know how the guy's alive because of he's an iron horse, that guy, I'm telling you. And massive brain bleed. And so last night they were side by side in hospital rooms receiving care. And so we pray for these dear ones. We love them and we hurt for them as they're in this valley, in this desert. We pray for their two children and the grandchildren and their spouses. And we pray for us and we pray for them. And so as we close today, as you go out and enjoy some coffee, as you parents get your kids and that, you may want to stay and just spend some time in prayer for them and prayer for your own heart, for praying for brothers and sisters and praying for God to do that great work in our lives in and through all of this. Remember, in all things, you are so loved by our great and our mighty God. We'll see you outside.
Temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. My righteous.